Hello everyone and welcome to this very long video here on my second channel. So today I'm going to be doing something that has sort of been a tradition for me the last couple of years. I'm going to do a full commentary of the videos that you just saw in my Best of Michael Noe from 2016 video. If you haven't checked it out for some reason, there'll be a link. Go do it. So we're going to see all of the videos in full length and I'm going to add behind the scenes commentary on them, so that should be exciting. All right, so let's get going, shall we? We start with I'm pretty sure that was actually my first upload of the year. My short film. I'm saying that in quotation marks. My short film called Stopping Time, which was it wasn't really a short film to begin with. Actually, it was. It's just a video, actually, but I didn't think that it belonged in the sketch genre, and so I just figured, let's just call it a short film, let's slap a cinematic filter on, and let's call it a short film. But, you know, I don't know, it's just, I don't know if that belongs in that category, especially on my channel, because usually when I make short films, it's a much bigger, like, budget and that sort of stuff, so it's not really the same thing. By the way, for the couple of you that might have watched just a little bit of the commentary that I did last year, I just want to apologize for that, because I said a lot of really weird stuff, but you have to understand, because I was watching it the other day, and I was incredibly tired, like, incredibly, when making it, and so that's why I just sort of, like, spaced out, like I was on some sort of drug or something, I don't know. Anyway, point is, I'm not going to be that weird today. Anyway, so, but yeah, normally my short films sort of have, it has a big budget, well, you know, it's a much bigger production, right? And I try at least to not play more characters. I've done that in two real short films, though. I've done it in the first long one that I made that was called Suicide and Bullying. I played the person that bullies me and the main character, the person being bullied. And then in my short film called The Devil's Learner, I also played both the dad and a person on a bicycle, which was just in need of better actors, I guess. But besides that, I try to refrain from being more characters in the short films that I make, and I would never make a real short film about my family characters. By the way, you might actually also have noticed that my family characters have sort of begun to die, if you will. I haven't really made a my family video in a year now or half a year's time or something. No, it's got to be like, I think like half a year probably. I'm not sure, but probably something like that probably. And the reason for this is because I became kind of sick of them. Like, I like doing characters, but I think they're just too ridiculous. And I sort of want to try and focus on more serious stuff. I mean, that's kind of why I jumped off of schedule on my main channel, is because I want to focus on serious, bigger and better stuff, you know. Obviously, I'm just picking, you know, quality over quantity. So that's why I've sort of stopped making the My Family videos, is because I just thought they were too ridiculous, and too overplayed. And it's because I thought to myself, would I be that's a funny scene. Anyway, sorry. It's because I thought to myself, would I be proud to show other people my Family videos? And the truth is just no. Like, it's just no. And besides that, I also feel like I'm running out of ideas with the characters. But anyway, this this short film, you can see the behind the scenes of it as well here on this channel. we had a lot of fun shooting it. Let me just put it like that. It was kind of awkward, like having to pull Marcus's pants down. We just, fuck, man. We just was bawling with laughter after, you know, having to record those scenes. So that was interesting. Anyway, so yeah, I mean, this short film, I like it and I'm proud of it, because I'm proud of a majority of my videos, actually, believe it or not. But it let me just put it like this. It will only get better down the road as we get into more and more videos from this past year. So, but it was actually, sorry, I forgot to mention, it was actually inspired by a Twilight Zone episode, the Twilight Zone. It was inspired by that. There was an episode, we move on to the next video, I'm sorry, I just want to finish this. It was inspired by the Twilight Zone episode about a dude who finds a clock that can stop time. And then he breaks into a bank in the end of it to steal money. And then he drops the clock on the floor and it stops working. And so he's sort of trapped in this loop in the ending where nobody moves and everything is frozen. And he's the only person left. So it's heavily inspired by that one. I wanted to make my own version. Anyway, so we move on to my video called the Back to the Future Intervention. Now, this and my last video we just saw were sort of me, for the first time, beginning to experiment with cinematic detail. So focusing way more heavily on framing, but not just that, also sound, but I've always sort of focused on that. But also lighting and sort of those sort of details, because I bought this DSLR camera about a year and a half ago, and I realized I could get some really, really, really beautiful pictures if I set it up the right way. And so I also, for once, I actually didn't film this in my graffiti-filled room, which I think is a good solution, a good idea. I used another room in our house. But I think this one is particularly beautifully shot. At this point, I wasn't actually using the autofocus. I mostly just use the autofocus these days because it's way easier. And on the DSLR cameras, there is a great autofocus function. So that's actually why, you know. But at this point, I was actually using a manual zoom. And so I really used a long time on framing it correctly with the zoom, and I have had several recordings ruined by the fact that I didn't manage to put the focus in the right way. So I've just sort of begun to use the autofocus function a lot because it runs like clockwork for the most part. The reason why I decided to shoot it outside is because obviously it looks more beautiful on a DSLR camera, because way more, like, it's tons of light is let in, and it's just very beautiful, more beautiful. But it was also because it has a way easier time focusing. It's way easier to make, you know, use the focus when you're outside, basically. Anyway, but I'm really proud of this one, not only for this sort of comedic silver lining, if you will, the comedic sort of standpoint, but also the cinematic standpoint, because I think this is one of the videos that I've ever made that was most beautifully shot. I really used a long time on making it as, like, beautiful as I could do, you know what I mean? Making the shots as beautiful as I could. And, you know, the result is thereafter, obviously. I love this one. I really do. I think it's really, really funny. The idea for this came from me always quoting Back to the Future to everyone around me, basically. And I wanted to make a video about that. I wanted to make a video just rehashing old trends and trying to make some new memes, perhaps. I don't know. So I wanted to... and also, I love the speech that I'm doing now from Breaking Bad. I love that. I love when he did that speech where he was like, you know who you're talking to right now? It gave me goosebumps. Like, it really did. And so I've always wanted to do that. And I even say that. Like, my character even says that. He says, I just always wanted to say that. So, and that is actually the truth. Like, I just always wanted to make a video saying that. Like, having that monologue in there. But no, but I, oh my god, I look so handsome in this. No, this will probably, in this long commentary video, will probably be a lot of me just commenting on how beautiful I am. Anyway, I'm just kidding. But I ended it with this message because I felt like it needed to have a premise. That's what I've sort of been also focusing on a lot this year, is premise, the premise for my videos. They must have a deeper meaning. instead of just being random. So that's also a change. Now we move on to probably the video that I put the most amount of effort into besides my big short films, which is my sketch video called How to Become a Hippie. Now, the backstory for this is, in 2015, I created a parody of a talk show that was supposed to have happened in the 1960s. And the major reason for making that one was because I wanted to try out the different effects, like that, sort of to make it old, like old footage effect. And also I wanted to poke fun at Britain and sort of the correlation of the Second World War and all that. And that's just, I made that video and I was so freaking proud of it. And it ended up becoming, like, I think my favorite video of 2015. And I wanted to make a part two, because I wanted to move it 10 years upwards to the 70s, because, you know, what classifies the 70s is the hippie revolution, the sort of, the way of that these sort of, groups started forming, where they would move together and live in these big houses together and not wear any clothes and fuck and all these, like, like the hippies, basically. And I wanted to make sort of a parody of that as well, because there was a lot of people, obviously, in that age that were very much against these hippies, these new age young people or whatever, because they felt like they were threatening their traditional values. And I wanted to sort of pair that up debatedly. Is that a word? I just invented it. Anyway, but the point is, I also wanted to give it that 70s feel, and you have no idea how many hours I spent in the editing room getting that 70s old vintage VHS effect. Like, it was so fucking hard. My great computer that has 16 gigabyte RAM and is especially made for editing, like, especially made from the ground up for editing videos, even had a hard time, like, making it, because there's so many effects added onto it. There's such a big work in it. But I have, obviously, the advantage that I have a green screen and appropriate lighting for that, so I can do a lot with that. So that's how this happened. Actually, fun fact, that you'll only hear on the commentary part, I was standing on my knees through all of this. I'm not even joking. I was standing on my knees as all three of these characters. And the reason for it is because my green screen is a 5x7 green screen. So it's not that big, and it was just a lot easier, because also the table that I used wasn't really that high up, and so it's just way easier being on my knees. So I was on my knees through all of recording this, and it was horrendous. Like, it fucking sucked, man. Do you have any idea how much that hurts? And my knees are weak to begin with, so that's kind of annoying anyway. I wanted to have appropriate clothing for it as well. I mean, for the first part where I made, you know, the first sort of parody of a talk show from the 60s, I wanted to bring in a prisoner or whatever. No, a real Nazi person. And so therefore I bought, like, a prisoner uniform or prisoner sort of costume, to sort of symbolize, hey, he's a prisoner in our country of Great Britain, because he's a fucking German. You know what I mean? So, and I wanted to do that as well here, and I thought that this shirt that I'm wearing right now in this shot would fit it perfectly with the color grading and everything and look sort of old. And then I bought this. Actually, it's supposed to be a doctor's costume, but it just looks like a white shirt. And somehow it just worked. Anyway, so we jump on to the next video, which is honestly one of the only times, if not the only time ever, that I've ever succeeded, in my personal opinion, succeeded in making random comedy, because I always script my videos. The majority of them I script, because I'm not that funny. Secret. I am not that funny. I'm really not. Like, it's really... And so I'm really bad at random humor. Like, I really am. And especially if, you know, if I'm doing a video, like, I'm really bad at humor if there's no other people around me for me to joke around with. I am sort of the jokester with my friends and whatnot, but when it comes to, like, shooting, I can't be funny on command, you know what I mean? So, and I just, the reason for making this was because I just got my driver's license, and I wanted to make one of these car videos because I had seen some people that had done it, and those were very funny. Like, for example, Comedy Shorts Gamer, he made a video, he's made a couple of them so far, where he's been driving his mom and his dad and now also his brother around in his Lamborghini. And those are very funny videos, and so I was very inspired by these all these car vlogs and car videos of people just, you know, having great banter in their car. And I was also especially inspired by the YouTuber Tom Rees-K, who is usually a sort of a Doctor Who YouTuber. He's a really great content creator, by the way. But he, in celebration of him going in full HD, he made a video of him showing his car and driving around in his car, and he just spent the whole time basically just making impressions, because he's really good at impressions. So he was just driving around speaking like David Tennant from Doctor Who and Matt Smith from Doctor Who, and like just, you know, and it was random and it was funny. And that's also what I was heavily inspired by, was this sort of way of being randomly funny while driving in your car. I mean, it's honestly a gift. If you can do that multiple times, I think you've got truly a gift. If you can just sit in your car and just fuck about, you know what I mean? And I think I sort of succeeded. Illuminati. I think that I kind of succeeded in that, being random and funny, if you will, because, believe it or not, I didn't plan any of it. I just sat in my car, put my camera up, and thought, let's shoot something. You know how I talked about earlier that when I used manual focus, it would fuck up some of my shots? This is a prime example of this. It accidentally focused on the wheel. I accidentally, you know, focused it on the wheel and not myself. Which is just horrible. So I'm out of focus right now. But I mean, the question is, how much does it really ruin the shot? Because yes, the wheel is in focus, and that's sort of what you're drawn to, your attention and your sort of your eyes are drawn to. But at the same time, the rest of the car is still blurry. So if you take away the wheel and pretend that the wheel is not there, what you'll be drawn to, your eyes, is still me. It'd be different if the whole car, we move on to the next video, I just want to finish this. It would be different if the whole car was in perfect focus, but I was out of focus. Anyway, so now we move on to the My Family sketch called Sick Day. I don't know, was this my last, I'm doubting myself at this point, but was this my last My Family sketch video that I uploaded? I think it was the last one I've made so far. I'm not sure. Don't hang me up on it. But I think it is, because after making this, I was like, I'm not doing this again. I'm not doing these characters again, because, you know, to be honest with you, there are some funny moments in this. And actually, it's the kind of video for me where I watch it when I watch it the first time around. When I made it, it was fucking horrible to me and not funny at all. But then I watch it, you know, after a long time, like after a year, for example, I watched it when I was editing the Best Of Michael Noack 2016, and I found it hilarious, to be honest. So it has some great comedic standpoints, I think, in my personal opinion. But it's just not really that good. And I mean, this video in particular is actually also the biggest reason, I think, why I jumped off of the schedule. Because again, it's about the quality over quantity for me, personally at least. Because, you know, I was on a weekly schedule, and I have to admit to you, this was forced. Like, this video was forced. I had to make something, you know what I mean? Because the way that I've been doing it for 4.5 years and making videos every single week while still having a life was that I stockpiled videos like crazy. So I would, in every vacation, I would make a video. Tons of videos. I would make 3 or 4 videos a week every week that I would have vacation throughout the year. And so I just, you know, had to make all these videos in a short amount of time, and they all had to be good, obviously. And I think I've been kind of successful in making them funny. But this one, I didn't feel it, man. I just didn't feel it. Like, I think you can sort of sense that it is forced. If you go watch it now after having heard me say that it was forced, you can definitely feel that it was forced. If you compare it to any of the earlier My Family videos that weren't as forced. You know, this was only made because I was running out of stockpile videos. Like, I had to fucking make something, you know what I mean? And it's just, it's not that great, to be honest with you. At least I don't think so. The only thing that's funny to me, and it might not be funny to anyone else, but it's funny to me, is the meta. Sort of how meta it is. Like, that we talk about the show on the show, and like, show me as the creator, and like, all these different, like, weird things, but it's funny to me. It's kind of like those movies that feature real people. Like, that's also why I love the movie, I think it was called This Is the End, or something. That James Franco and Seth Rogen and Jonah Hill and all these, you know, people that have made comedy movies together before, they made it, and they were playing sort of overdramatic versions of themselves, I guess, and that was very meta as well. But I feel like that's the only really fun part about that sketch video. So now we move on to my second car video. Don't worry if you're thinking, wow, he uploaded two car vlogs right after each other. No, I didn't. But it was just, you know, it was in the compilation. Anyway, point is, now we move on to the car vlog I made with Marcus. And, you know, here's how I feel about this one. I don't feel like the content within the car was funny. Like, when we were sitting in the car talking and having great banta. I don't feel like that was funny at all, to be honest with you. I just thought that was a little bit, you know, me trying too hard to be funny, I guess. But I think the outside footage, because I did way more outside footage in this video than in the first car vlog. And I think the outside footage makes up for maybe the lack of quality in the car scenes. Because I think when we were walking around in that amusement park, I thought we had some really funny footage, and that's also why I put it in the Best of My 2016 video, was because I thought those scenes when we were just walking around being stupid, I thought that those scenes were funny as fuck. Like, I'm gonna be honest with you. So I think it makes up for it in this particular instance. I think the outside scenes makes up for whatever's happening in the car right now. So the only problem I have with this was, to get the wide angle lens, the fish eye effect or whatever, we used the GoPro to film this. And the problem with that is, it doesn't focus. Like, everything is just in focus. So you can so clearly see everything around us, and we're not really brought into focus, which is just, it looks horrible. Because you can see, for like a good amount of time, you can see this bus just like driving behind us, and now it's making a turn, but you can see the cars behind us, and that's not a good thing. And you can see what we drive past and that sort of stuff, and that's not a good thing. And also, obviously, there's the problem of the dashboard. But the reason why the dashboard is in there, and you could go, well, couldn't you just zoom in? The problem was, I couldn't, because that would ruin the quality even more. Because I've already pixelated it a little bit, because I zoomed in a lot when I was making it, when I was editing it in the first place, because it was just kind of badly shot in terms of the GoPro. Like, it was filming way too much. The GoPro was filming way, like, too wide-eyed. So, you know, this is how much I was willing to zoom in without, I think, fucking the pixelation up completely. So that's also why you can see a definite sort of loss in quality. I can see that, at least, when I look at this video. There's a definite loss of quality in these GoPro scenes. Whereas when we step outside, which we do now, boom. Now, way better quality. And you can just see that. It's way better flow. It's way better. It makes us look way, way better than we actually do. You know what I mean? So, anyway, that was a sweet-ass car. Fuck. But this is the vlog inside of the amusement park. which I guess was my humble beginnings to the daily vlog experiment that I was running on my on this second channel throughout all of December, because I was having so much fun doing this sort of daily vlogging type content within this amusement park that I thought, you know what, fuck it, man, I'm just going to be a daily vlogger for a month. but it was way harder than I had imagined. But anyway, point is, but no, I had a lot of fun shooting this and just being random and just walking around. But that's the thing. I think vlogs where you just sort of walk around the daily vlog kind of thing format can be extremely entertaining if you do the right things. But I guess my life is just too boring because I don't every day do really funny things. But I think, you know, we were in a funny amusement park, so obviously it was funny, like, you know what I mean? And you can't criticize me for the rape jokes, because that is a cheap shot. Like, I was making all these jokes about raping Marcus, but honestly, if you want to know the reason why those jokes are in there, it's because that's our banter. That's what we do. Like, that's what we do. That's what we be doing when we hang out and whatnot. We make tons of really over-sexualized jokes. And at this point in time, our flow was me making rape jokes at Marcus, basically. Like, I'm not gonna lie. So it was just, we actually just behaved like ourselves. Like, nothing is, I didn't act more sort of over sexual in this than I did in real life at this point in time. So we were actually, believe it or not, just being ourselves. Which is sort of hard to believe, maybe. I don't know. But, like, okay. I just want to say that this H3H3 parody itch that I'm doing right now is no offense to Ethan and Hila. It's a tribute, if anything. Because I fucking love H3H3. And I had just discovered them at this point when filming this. And discovered their channel. And I had been binge-watching them, like, insanely binge-watching. And, and it just, you know, I thought they were too hilarious. They were just so fucking hilarious. And the reason why I was doing this Ethan impression, whatever, was because Marcus was filming me, just like Hila always films Ethan when they're doing videos. So that was, I just don't want anyone to take offense by it. I was not trying to make fun of his Tourette's. I know he has Tourette's. It was just, it's more like a visual gag when you're trying to impersonate someone. You got to go for cheap shots to make it funny, I think. But anyway, so now we're back in the car. I really don't like the physical quality of this. Like the physical, like, pixelation and whatnot. But anyway, so we move on to my first real short film of the year called Journey to the Future. And when I say real, I mean the one with sort of a bigger cast. And sort of more professional-ish than the first one. And this is actually my voice. And I've gotten feedback from people that have said, you know, in real life, that they could not hear that it was me. Because I over-pitched, well, chose such a low pitch for my voice. So I think it works. Also because, you know, I sort of changed the way that I speak to sort of be more like a young person, if you will. Hey, yo, come on, dude, let's smoke some fucking weed, you know what I mean? Like, that sort of tango, if you will, that sort of lingo of speaking. Now, one thing that I'm kind of a little bit annoyed about in terms of this short film, there's two things. The first thing is the trademark sign that I put. I'm not regretting putting that trademark sign in, because I want to trademark, obviously, the productions that I've used an insane amount of time on, if they should be freebooted. So I don't regret putting it there, but I think you'll find when we see my short film called Thou Shall Not Lie, the trademark will be way less visible, if you will. So the truth of the matter is, if you watch my daily vlogs, you'll know the team that made this short film, which was me, Marcus, and then our friend Casper. And now we have sort of our little own voluntarily production company, if you will. We're not a real production company by any sense, but we have our own sort of film office that we meet up in, like once a week, and just do shit, like make movies and whatnot, and come up with ideas, and just sort of because it's our biggest hobby, all three of us. And this lovely young lady that you're seeing to my side here was very sweet to help us out. She was a person that we sort of knew through other people, I guess. I don't know. We did a favor for another group that were doing this musical parody thing of this Michael Jackson song, and we made that for them. We filmed it for them and edited it for them. It was sort of a promo for... Anyway, it's a longer story. But anyway, so they sort of owed us a favor, so we asked, could you bring in one of your crew members to help us out with this short film? And she was so nice to be in it, and I think she actually pulled off an amazing job. I mean, she's not at any point have ever said that she was an actor and just helped us out because she was doing us a favor, and I think she did a pretty good job considering the fact that she wasn't, you know, had any experience with acting to begin with. Now, this scene, you might have thought to yourself, why are you abusing Marcus by strapping him in with all this duct tape? But the truth is, Marcus actually wanted us to tie him up. That sounds weird. But no, but the point was, we were going to tie him up with duct tape, but we sort of tied him up, and then he was like, well, but we didn't have any duct tape on his throat. And some other places on him as well. And he said, wouldn't it be more realistic if you put more duct tape on me? And so I'm just saying he didn't have a problem with it. No Marcuses were harmed in the making of this video. I just want to clarify that. So the basic point is we didn't harm Marcus. The other thing that sort of bothered me about this short film was that there is an ending scene. There is an ending scene which wraps up all of the, gives the short film a real premise, and also makes the beginning scene make any sense. In this version, the beginning scene is more sort of just random, if anything. It's just, you know, it has no ties with the storyline, I guess. If you took that scene out, the short film could still work. But it was supposed to all be added up in a bigger sort of, I don't know how to phrase it, but a bigger sort of understanding and message in the end scene, where Marcus's character actually has another conversation on the phone with the friend that he was talking with in the beginning about how he's learned his lesson, he doesn't hate his parents anymore. Basically, the whole premise is he was just dreaming all this. And it sort of learned him to appreciate his family a lot more and to not complain about his parents being assholes or whatever that he was doing in the beginning. Now, the reason I just want to add this, the reason why I put on a cap is because between the last shot and this one, between the last scene and this one, I got a haircut, which that's not good for continuity. So I thought, I'll just put on a fucking cap. Who cares, right? And I borrowed this from my friend Benjamin, who's been in my my video, Slow-Mo Tricks, Awesome Slow-Mo Tricks. Anyway, that was supposed to add it all up, this ending scene of him talking on the phone with his friend and sort of being like, you know what, I actually feel bad about what I said about my parents, they're actually great people, blah, 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 all these things, and like learning that family is an important thing and all this, sort of learning his lesson. But that scene I was not able to take. I love this slow-mo scene, by the way. But I was not able to use that scene because of the wind. It just fucked it up. It just fucked up the audio recording. And I first discovered that when I was editing the short film. So, and at that point, it was too late to go out and reshoot it. So I sort of edited my way out of it by just having him wake up in the box and just walk away. But it sort of makes the first scene where he talks on the phone with his buddy, makes it a bit more pointless. But anyway. Also, going on a side note, if you've watched my daily vlogs, you should know we have another project coming up that I told you about called The Road to Success, which is going to be a web series, a mockumentary web series. And good news is we have actually made a plan for it now. like the scripts are written for all five episodes. Everything is it's done in that regard. And yesterday we finished our plans of like when we're going to shoot it at the certain times and what scenes at the certain dates and blah blah blah. So that now it will, it's pretty bound. It's bound to actually happen. I'm don't hang me up on this, but I'm saying there is probably a 90% possibility that we will make that mockumentary series. Anyway, I just wanted to add that. And the reason why I wanted to add that was, is that the crew is going to be the same. Like, it's also going to be me, Casper, and Marcus, and another person. But anyway, so, yeah. Woohoo! Credits! And copyright. Michael Novak, 2016. Alright, so we... I'm really proud of that short film, by the way. I liked it. The only thing that I'm sort of unsatisfied about is my own acting in it. I think that my acting sucked, but I thought Marcus and our female friend was very good, and Casper even to a certain degree. So now we move on to, I think, probably the funniest video I've made this year, well, this past year. It's my top 10 worst YouTube videos. Now, it is heavily inspired by Jax Films, who made a video called the Top 10 Best Videos on YouTube, which was also a joke. He was showcasing shitty videos and making them out to be, you know, and pretending like they were really great. So I kind of stole that idea, but I like to think it's still only like just inspired because the idea is the same, but you know, by making fun of these all these shitty videos. But at the same time, the idea was also sort of mine to use the videos that I did use, and I wrote it on myself, and my jokes are my own, and that sort of stuff. So I won't really call it ripping off, but it is heavily inspired by Jax Films' video. But it is one of my, like, all-time favorite videos I've ever done, and I did a video that we'll see later on, which is called Top 5 Ways to Become Famous on YouTube, I think. And that video I only made because I was rewatching this and thought to myself, this is so fucking good. I want to make another video like this, you know? So I'm really proud of this one. And I think the funniest part of this was actually, you know, due to the editing. Because of all the funny clips that I put with these particular content creators. And, you know, if you think I'm overusing that Nicole Arbour thing and thinking that's a dead meme... It wasn't at the time of making this, at least I don't feel like it was. I feel like it was still sort of a hot topic when making this. So I feel like it was still sort of relevant at this point, but maybe it was a little bit dead anyway. I probably wouldn't make any Nicole Arbour jokes at this point because she's dead, motherfucker. She's gone. But I love this clip with this woman. I literally just searched on YouTube for how to laugh, like, and her video came up of like, I think I searched for like fake laughing or something, and her video came up, and it's just a 4-minute cringy video of her teaching you how to laugh, and it sounds so fake when she does it, and I thought this is perfect, this is fucking perfect for my video, so obviously I had to include this in my compilation video. And also make fun of the Bradbury Bunch, obviously, and make fun of Killer Keemstar, obviously as well. I had to make fun of him as well, and it's more sort of a jab at him, because at this point I was still furious over the fact that he called an innocent person a pedophile. In my personal opinion, it's going to get real for a second. In my personal opinion, I think that is the worst thing you can do towards another human being, is call them a pedophile, because you destroy their entire life. You destroy their entire life, their reputation, everything. And you can destroy everything. So you better be fucking sure of the fact that this person is a pedophile. And Keemstar simply did not do his research. If you take one look at the real guy who is a sex offender and a pedophile, and then Tony, you can see such a huge fucking difference. So actually, it's more sort of me saying, you know, in a comedic way, that Keemstar is a fucking, like, horrible person for doing this. Anyway, Max Mofo, I love Max Mofo's videos, actually. That's the thing about this. Not all of the videos that I used that it's not all the videos that I use that I hate or whatever or dislike in any sense. I think a few of them that I used were actually really funny. Like, for example, this one. I like Max Mofo's videos, you know? Also, by the way, this clip that is going to come up right now of me saying that SoFlo was a saint for bringing attention to this serious topic was obviously sarcastic. I just want to say that in case somebody, you know, people didn't understand it. Anyway. But yeah. So, regarding the videos that I chose for this... sorry, one second. Sorry. So, regarding the videos that I used for this Top 10 Worst YouTube Videos video, not all of them were videos that I dislike at all. I like Max Mofo's videos, you know. I even see an entertainment values in an entertainment value in Nicole Arbour's videos as well. It's a mixed bunch. I'll put it like that. And I don't hate Watch Mojo either. I've probably watched a lot of their videos. In fact, you know, but I Hate Everything does have a point with this, saying that it's just an emotionless shit production company or whatever. Just fucking mass-producing content that's shitty and just feeding the YouTube algorithm, which is something that I do despise them for, abusing the algorithm like this to get themselves on top, you know. So number one, as we see here, now the reason why I picked this video for number one is not because it's the worst of the bunch, but it's because it's fucking BuzzFeed. And I've always... I fucking hate BuzzFeed. And I love making fun of them, but I want to do it in a proper way because I think it's a bit of an overused meme at this point to make fun of BuzzFeed. So I want to integrate it in my videos as sort of a subtle thing and not make full videos about, oh, I fucking hate BuzzFeed. And I've considered so many times making response videos to BuzzFeed simply because they make such stupid videos. But I think everyone already does it, so it's like, what's the point? You know what I mean? But so I wanted to take a jab at them in a funny and creative and original way. I think I succeeded. So here's my copyright disclaimer. I feel like this is important to put on the videos that where I do use clips, just to be sure. You know, I don't know if it has any real effect, but I like to put it there anyway. So now we move on to the video where I roasted some YouTubers. Damn, I look good in this video. See, I told you it was gonna come. Me, just. Complimenting myself, but anyway, but no, yeah, I this video, okay, some people were offended by this video, because I was making fun of their favorite creators, obviously, and obviously, I actually expected a bigger backlash than what I did get some positive comments, and I didn't expect for that at all, and I expected to lose subs and all that stuff, but some people understood that it was just for comedy, which I just want to make so fucking clear. It is for comedy purposes. Like, it's a joke. It is a joke video. You shouldn't take anything seriously that I say in this. However, I also just want to add that, obviously, whenever you do make jokes, it still comes from a place of honesty. So, I do, you know, some of these opinions I do carry, actually, in real life, but the majority of it is just me, just, you know, just making fun of these people without really meaning to, without really, well, of course I meant to make fun of them, but without meaning to offend them or harass their fans or whatever. But I just wanted to drop some truth bombs. This video is heavily inspired by Onision's video, actually, where he was talking to YouTubers face-to-face, sort of like I do here, but in a more sort of serious way, I guess, a serious manner, and calling out YouTubers. So I just wanted to do the same. So I literally just took my camera to my yard, just put it up, and just started shooting, like, without a script, without any thought process, just, you know, just having the premise in my head of wanting to make fun of some YouTubers, and I just said what came off the top of my head. So that's also why you shouldn't take it seriously, because there's no thought process behind this video, other than me just thinking about the premise for it for a few minutes, you know. But I think this is the biggest giveaway with Keemstar. I say that he's the only sane person on the website. Now that should, if you're unsure whether this is a joke video or not, that should definitely convey you. Like, that should definitely and make you believe the fact that it's a fucking joke video. I called Keemstar the only sane person on YouTube. Are you fucking kidding me? Of course I didn't fucking mean that, you know what I mean? So I think that's the biggest sort of, that was my way of sort of giving it away that, hey, I'm just making a bit of fun, you know, I'm just joking. Don't take it seriously, you fucking idiots, you know what I mean? Anyway, but I did get some angry comments from some angry fanboys and girls, which is always nice. I do love Five Who fans, though, I just want to add that. And, I mean, Daniel, I mean, I think his videos are a bit stale, it's a bit much of the same, which is why I think his channel is kind of dying, but I just wanted to comment on the fact that he talks about his mental issues maybe too much, like, maybe it's hashtag TMI, I'm not really sure. And Vegan Games is just insane, like, I just want to add that. MM Vivo. It's, now that, the reason why I mentioned Eminem Vivo was to make fun of the fact that these Vivo channels have officially, taken over YouTube, and the most subscribed channels are fucking Vivo channels, which is just so unfair to all content creators that work hard on their videos, you know, but I do like Eminem's music videos, I do, what can I say? So, now it's time for this video, which is called The Pranksters Apologize to H3H Productions. Now, this video was actually, believe it or not, a tribute video to H3H3. And you might think to yourself, well, that's a bit obvious, Michael. But I'm not really sure that it is. Because I've gotten, like, I got a comment that said, you're just doing the same as H3H3 Productions, just copying. And I was like, hello, it's a tribute video to them, you fucking idiot. Like, I'm guessing he was talking about the edit in the ending of this, where I took some of their funniest clips and put together, sort of like they've done in their series .exe. But isn't it obvious that this is a tribute? Like, it's not me copying their style, which I guess I do copy their style, but in the remix thing. But it's a tribute to them. It's a tribute to H3H3. Because, like I said, I love their content, and I love the fact that they call out these bullshit YouTubers, like, and the pranksters especially, you know, and they've actually managed to do some real damage to these bullshit YouTubers, you know. And I wanted to make this, I thought to myself, I wonder what would happen if the pranksters were forced, or whatever, to apologize to H3, you know what I mean? What if they all of a sudden came to their senses and just apologized? And I wrote the script for where the pranksters speak to the camera, and I was like, this is not going to be a very long video. So I was like, I'll throw in this little sketch part, but it still wasn't a very long video. So I threw in the edit thing. And all in all, I think it's a really funny and great video. And the win did fuck up a lot of this, I think, in my personal opinion, but it's really funny. I really like this. This is really funny. It's just a prank, bro. Like, because that's what they do. I'm Ethan Barbary. This guy's amazing, by the way. The first guy that you saw for making these specialized video messages to people. I'm Ethan Barbary. I think this video is pretty good. I mean, I'm proud of it. I won't lie. I watch it again now and then. Because I'm proud of it, and I think this tribute in the ending was really good. So now we move on to the pride of my year, the best thing I've created all year, which is my big budget short film, Thou Shall Not Lie. Now, this video, this short film, in this, I have never paid more attention to cinematic detail than in this short film. Now, what I mean by that is everything that you see in this short film is beautifully shot with the perfect framing and everything. And there's, you know how, like, you watch movies and then every decision, every shot you see has a meaning behind it? I've never done videos like that, or short films, by that matter. You know, but in this one I did. Like, every shot that you see has a point to it. And I've never made the beginning montage. I've never made one of those before in my short films, and I also made that for this one. a beginning montage where you see the flower, which represents the story. I just want to explain that quickly. The flower represents the main character. So first you see a flower that hasn't sort of sprung out yet, and then you see a flower that sort of has, and then it sort of, you know, has more sprung out, and then in the ending, it's become rotten. It's become, you know, too old. And there, and how we shot that was we found four of the exact same flowers in that order where they were, you know, the first one was not sprung in, like, so we filmed that to symbolize the evolution of the main character, because an opening to a film should always explain the entirety of what's going to happen in that film. You should be able to tell by the opening, and you might think, I've never seen that in a big budget Hollywood movie, but yes, you have. You just haven't paid attention to it because it happened so fast, it happened so rapidly. But every opening of every Hollywood short film will reveal the plot of the movie. So it's important for that beginning montage to have that, to spoil the movie, I guess. You know what I mean? You're supposed to, as a film critic, you're supposed to only look at the opening and be able to tell, when you analyze the opening, what the movie's going to be about. And this was our way of doing that in a simple way, of just showing, you know. And I think it should be obvious to people that we didn't just film flowers because, hey, flowers are beautiful. We shot them because there is a meaning to it. We used months on filming this, and parts of it, like you saw, were filmed at my high school, my earlier high school, that I graduated from here in the summer of 16. And the reason why we filmed there was to sort of give the general consensus to the story, like, that this person is just an average high school student, which he is. The thing about my short films is sometimes I've written stories that, you know, featured around, you know, what was supposed to be, like, older adults. And the fact of the matter is, we're young people who make this. We're not, you know, 30 or 40 years old. So there's no point in pretending to be like that, to pretending to be older. And that's what I've realized. So now when I make short films and, like, big-budgeted stuff, like, for example, my series that I'm going to make, I have sort of stepped away from pretending to be something that I'm not, you know what I mean? Pretending to be an older person, you know? So this short film features around it's because I want my short films to have a sense of realism. I think that's the most important thing. I watched a French movie called Blue is the Warmest Color. You should really go check it out. It's a 3-hour-long film. And it doesn't have a happy ending. You might be surprised at that, but it doesn't. Because the most important thing for the director was to have a sense of realism in his productions. And it's the same way for me, honestly. It's the same way for me. I also want my movies to have a sense of realism. They can still have a happy ending. They can still have some sort of overnatural, effects or whatever. But the general storyline it's just way better, in my personal opinion, if it's realistic. And I think this movie has a big sense of realism. Not in the sense that his lies have actual world consequences, because it doesn't in real life, you know, obviously. But even that's cleared up in the ending, where you see the friend who has basically betrayed him or whatever, and to teach him a lesson, and paid all these people to act like they, you know, for example, these two girls to act like they live in his house and all that. So, you know, I'm just saying, like, it's I try to make it as realistic as possible, you know, in the sense that, you know, having this continued sense of realism, you know, it's very important to me. I can't even put into words how proud I am of this production, like, honestly. And I know they aren't watching, because why would they? But if at any time any of the four other people that I made the short film with ever see this, ever listen to this, I just want to say thank you. Thank you so much. Because we all put such a huge amount of effort into this, some more than others, obviously, but the three guys, you know, me and these two that are talking in this scene, we poured so many man hours into this. We poured so much love and energy and hard work into it. And it just shows. It just shows that for once, I didn't do all the work for a short film. Okay, I did edit it alone. I did write it mostly on my own as well. You know, there is that sort of sense. And I did direct it and also star in it, just like I always do. But you can sense, I think, that it's a team effort. You know, for the first time in any of my productions, you can actually sense that it's a team effort, you know? And I especially like the scene, like, symbolically, because it shows, you know, how he's being broken down by these lies in real life. Like, he's being, you know, which I think will happen. If you lie too much, it will become such a habit for you that you'll do it without even realizing. And that's when you step into dangerous territory, is when you... When you start just telling lies just because you've gotten so used to it that you don't even think about it anymore, that you don't, you know, when you get to the point where you don't make up lies to get out of something or to make things go more smoothly, you know, for your own benefit, but you just do it just because you've gotten so used to it, you know? So I think it's just... I mean, I don't know. It's all food for thought, I guess. I think this short film is very much up to the individual that's watching. So if you, whatever you take from it, whatever you think of it, you know, symbolically, what it all means and why we all did it or whatever, is, you know, there's no right and wrong answer to that, in my personal opinion, you know? It's all about how you perceive this short film, because I think it does have multiple meanings and multiple sort of premises, if you will. You know, the obvious one is he lies and gets real consequences for it, and, you know, through that whole thing learns his lesson. But I think you can draw way more from this production. I think you can take way more out of it in terms of relating it to everyday life things. Of like, maybe, you know, the reason why I made this story was because I wanted also people to think about the fact that when they do lie, it does have consequences. Maybe not immediately, maybe not, you know, obviously not in the same way that it does in this short film, but it does have consequences. And it is important to sort of just think about for a second. You know, just to realize how much we all lie every single day of our lives. Maybe we just want to take that into account. Like, even if it's smaller lies, which the majority of us just make small lies. Like, if your girlfriend asks you, does my butt look big in this? And you're like, no, honey, you look great. Like, that sort of small white lies, we all make those all the time, obviously. You know, and the majority of us lie every single day, you know. But it's become such a habit for us that we don't even realize that we're doing it. And that's the whole point. That's the whole point of this short film. But I'm really proud of it. You know, if I had to come with any sort of negative aspects of this, anything that I'm sort of, and I'm just nitpicking at this point, but then I would say maybe it's the main character, Nikolai. Maybe it's his acting. Now, you know, no criticism at all, because he's never claimed to be an actor. He's never claimed to know how to act or to be good at acting or anything like that. So I'm not blaming Nikolai for, you know, being bad at acting or whatever, because he's never claimed to be good at it, you know, and I recognize that, obviously. You know, but it does sort of become, especially with the scene that you just saw with him breaking down, it does seem maybe just a tiny bit overdone, if you will, overplayed, to a point where it sort of loses its meaning, if you will, or not its meaning, but it loses the effect that it's supposed to give the viewer that's watching. You're supposed to sort of feel with this person, feel bad for this person or whatever, and sympathize with him. And I think maybe it takes that out of it because of his, you know, a little bit poor acting skills. But he's amazing. He's an amazing person. I don't want to bash him at all. But you can see in these credits that a lot of not only work went into this, but also a lot of people were part of it. So now we come to my Oh my God, we've been running for an hour now. shit, my voice, I'm losing my voice at this point. Now we come to the video where I make fun of Facebook. It's called Debunking Memes, I think. What's it called? Fun with Facebook. Debunking Memes. And it's heavily inspired by... I take a lot of inspiration from other YouTubers, I just realized that. No, it's heavily inspired by Sears' video that he made called... He's made two of them called Kill Your Meme. I watched those and I was like, this is so fucking funny. So again, I just pulled out my camera and did something random and just roused on Facebook for 10 minutes and tried to be funny, I guess. And I don't know if I succeeded in the random funny department this time. That's what I talked about earlier, was the whole, that in the first car vlog, that's the only video, in my opinion, that I think that I truly succeeded in being funny, randomly funny. You know what I mean? Without a cue card, without a script, you know. I don't know if I fully succeed in this. I still think it's funny. And if anything, you can just appreciate the visual and the audio-visual quality. Because, oh my God, just look at how beautifully it's shot. And listen to it as well. It has this really nice microphone effect or whatever. But I wanted to make fun of Facebook. You know, because I see so much bullshit on it every single fucking day, and I just wanted to comment on that. Oh my God, I look good in this video. See, now we go again with me complimenting myself. I need to stop doing that. Anyway, I just think I'm a handsome bloke. I mean, I'll be honest with you. Let's get real for a second. You know, after I've lost a considerable amount of weight, well, I'm about halfway of where I want to be, but I can notice it when I look at myself. Like, I think I was a pretty ugly dude before I started to lose weight. And I think now that it's had a way more positive effect on my, on the way that I look appearance-wise that I've lost weight. And I just think that I look really good now. And I think I should be allowed to feel that way without feeling bad about it. I think I should be allowed to, you know, pat myself on the shoulder and, you know, be proud of the fact that I have made some achievement in that, and it has also worked a lot on my my low self-esteem, which is something that I've had for almost 10 years, a low self-esteem, and it's worked wonders on that. Like, I've gotten way more self-esteem, and it's made my life a lot, I think, easier to live because of the self-esteem thing. So, you know, it's just made me more confident as a person, and I think that's just amazing. And to the person, Benjamin, who sort of peer pressured me, if you will, into starting a gym membership, I just want to say to you, thank you, because I'll be forever grateful for that. Because before I did that, before I started a gym membership, I was miserable, because I looked myself in the mirror and thought, what a disgusting human being. Like, I didn't like the way that I looked, and that's obviously also why I had a low self-esteem, you know. That got really weird, real and dark all of a sudden, but my general point was just that I've gotten a lot happier and also a lot more energy, obviously, but also it's just helped me, for example, in my new education that I just started, that you know about if you've watched the daily vlogs. It's helped me be a lot more social on that education, which has just been a really big plus for me, because for once I'm not the introverted person anymore. Like, I'm not the person that just sits quietly and doesn't talk to anyone. I'm actually part of the class, sort of, I don't know what you can call it, but the community in the class, if you will, you know, and that feels great. For once, because, man, it's been like 10 years since I was, you know, a real part of the community in the class. And you know, I've always just sort of stuck to myself and just hung out with a couple of people, but never really been part of, like, the class as a whole, you know, or felt welcome when I've been, you know, in high school and in elementary school. So I'm just... It just feels really nice to be part of that for once. Anyway, I got sidetracked. It does happen a lot for me. I just want to warn you there. But now we move on to, like I was talking about earlier, my second attempt at trying to make this list video and trying to be funny. So I made a top 5 ways to become famous on YouTube. And this is funny for one particular reason. And that's the fact that, you know, basically the reason why I made this video was just as a way to, poke fun of these YouTubers that I just think are so ridiculous, because I see so much shit in the YouTube community. Like, I see so many shit YouTubers that are making so much money on this shit, and people, you know, they praise them and they put them on a pedestal, and they just don't deserve it, because their content is bullshit and they're horrible people in real life. You know what I mean? Like, I still can't understand why people still watch Matthew Santoro after finding out that he's fucking ripped off every single, like, almost every single fact video that he's done. He's ripped it off from Listverse. You know what I mean? Like, that's just, and you know, here I'm making fun of the cute emo-haired British YouTubers, which there is just still way too many of, in my personal opinion. I mean, one is too many, in my opinion, but anyway. But these YouTubers that are famous because they're cute and they're British and they're, you know, they have a long hair and they, you know what I mean? And look emo. Like, what? What? You, like, the reason why they have such a huge fan base, like, Dan and Phil, don't flame me. But the reason why Dan and Phil have such a huge fan base of very violent little girls is because they're pretty. It's because they're physically attractive. And that's just bullshit. And obviously, I had to make fun of Leafy. You know, I think my Leafy impression is pretty good, you know. What's up, guys? Welcome to a brand new video. You know, and I think it's just hilarious in such an ironic way that Leafy is dying, that his channel is dying. Because it just shows you that if you don't evolve on your content, you're gonna die out. And I also think it's him tasting his own medicine, because he's destroyed people's self-esteem and their YouTube channels for a number of years by making fun of them and his shit content, you know. And now it's finally happened to him. He's finally got a bit of his own medicine, you know. He makes a living criticizing other people that don't deserve to be criticized, like children and mentally handicapped, and that's just not okay, man. It's just not, you know. It's just, you know, and I think it's horrible. I think it's a horrible thing that he's doing, you know what I mean. And so I'm so glad that he's finally gotten to taste his own medicine. Anyway, so, I'm just listening to myself. Making fun of the drama channels, yeah. This is another jab at your boy Keemstar. I'll be honest, I've gotten way more respect, if you can call it that, appreciation at least for him after listening to Baited, which I think he's amazing on Baited, you know. So you know, he's kind of gained some points in my book, and he did sort of also say that in, I think it is the latest Baited episode, he said it, that the Baited podcast became his second chance of sort of clearing up his name and giving him a platform for him to defend himself and to explain how he's not actually a horrible guy, you know. So I don't know. I'm still in the sort of consensus that I don't know if I should forgive Keemstar completely, you know, and be a huge fan or whatever of him. But he is talented, whether you like to admit it or not. He's funny. He's entertaining. And he knows how to play the YouTube game. Like, he's you know, you gotta give it to him, you know, whether you like him or not. And he has done a lot, I think, to redeem himself from the shit that he's done, you know. Anyway, so I thought it was a perfect way to end off this comedy sketch that you just saw with, obviously, with a Shoe Nice clip. I fucking love Shoe Nice, because, in my personal opinion, Shoe Nice, and you might think he's actually like that, but he's not, dude. He's a character, and he's trolling. And I think he's a genius, because he's trolled the system for years. He's been able to troll the system. without any people, like, without the majority of people figuring him out. Like, the majority of people still think he's a real person, like, that he acts like that in real life, you know? And I think he's just, he's such a great troller. He's so great at trolling. It's unbelievable. And back with the doctor's costume thing. It does kind of work. And we slap these really ridiculous glasses on my on Marcus. It's actually my mother's reading glasses. So that's a fun fact. By the way, I just realized I haven't really talked any real behind-the-scenes stuff like that you might not know. But I don't know if there's that much to tell, to be honest. There probably is, but I don't know. But this video... I'm really proud of it. I think it's become really good. I made it at a time where people were starting to make fun of the food reviewers. And to be honest, I don't really have a problem with the food reviewers. I mean, I don't think that their content is particularly enjoyable, and I don't watch it myself. But they're not hurting anyone, you know what I mean? They're not making fun of other people. They're not trying to ruin people's careers. They're not getting involved in drama. They're just eating on camera. And if people like seeing that, that's up to them. But to be honest, when I'm looking back on this, to the scenes in the car where I eat the McChicken, that's just cringy to me. And that's how I feel when watching these food reviews is, it's just fucking cringy to watch some dude eat for for 5 minutes, you know what I mean? So, I do make fun of the food reviewers in this video, but it is in the kindest way I could possibly imagine, because like I said, I don't have a problem with them. I don't think that they should stop making videos, or, that their content should, cease to exist or whatever. And I'm not the type of person that's gonna say it's fucking cancer, because like I said, it's not hurting anyone, and it's just, so I just wanted to make a lighthearted sort of joke about them, and but also with a serious meaning, because obviously if you are a food reviewer, and if you're like Dame Drops, for example, who makes food reviews like every single fucking day almost, it is going to have a serious consequence for your health. Like, take it from, takes one to know one. Like, I being fat myself, and having been fat for the past 10 years, I can tell you it has consequences. Luckily, I've never gotten asthma, any of these diseases, but that you usually get when you're overweight. But I have, it has obviously... done a lot to my physical health. Like, I've gotten weak knees over it. Obviously my physical form is not that great. I get very I get exhausted quicker than other people. It just has a lot of really bad consequences. And the meaning behind this video was just to sort of say to the food reviewers, please just take a moment to stop and just consider, do I want to sacrifice literally my life for my YouTube videos and for my YouTube audience? Because I'm a strong believer in the fact that if you like eating, and if you don't have a problem being fat or dying early or whatever, if you don't give a fuck, which some people don't, I think you should continue doing what you do. I mean, it's... But I also just want to say, like I'm writing here, that it's never too late to make a change. Like, takes one to know one, right? I've been, massively overweight for 10 years, and, I've done something about it now. It's never too late. I just want people to understand that. It's never too late. All it takes is the right mindset, and all it takes is you wanting to get help, and wanting to do it and commit yourself. That's all it takes. That's all it takes, personally, I don't know if I believe in the whole thing of, like, you gotta have a great willpower, because I don't consider myself a person that has a great willpower, yet I've still been able to commit myself to working out, for example, for the past, a year and 4 or 5 months at this point, and I've also been able to commit myself to a healthier lifestyle and healthier and making healthier choices every day. So, and it's not rocket science, and everything becomes a habit, and you just got to make it a habit to live a healthier life. Anyway, So that ran way over time. Now we're on the 2016 politics video that I made. Now the reason for making this was because obviously it was blowing up the internet at that point, and it's obviously the biggest thing that happened this year. Like, even if you're not a U.S. citizen, it's still the biggest thing in the media that's happened this year, obviously, because it always is, and especially this year because of Donald Trump, you know. And so, I didn't want to originally make a video about it and comment on it or whatever, because everyone was doing that. And I don't like to do what everyone else is doing, but I also don't want to pretend like it didn't happen. Like, I think it's important to recognize that, yes, this happened. Now, what do we, where do we go from here? You know, also a little fun fact, yesterday in class, after I had told my classmates a little bit more about my YouTube personality and my YouTube channel, they fucking played this video out loud so that everyone could hear. And they were standing in a group watching it. And that made me feel so uncomfortable. And it's not the first time it's happened to me. But that makes me feel so fucking, you know, so fucking uncomfortable. I've also discovered that in my class, there are a few other YouTubers as well. And in my school in general, there are quite a few number of YouTubers, which is insane. Like, but I suppose it makes sense, right? We all have the same passion. But yeah, anyway, so back to the whole point. I didn't want to just continue like it didn't happen and ignore it and just say, well, la 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 la, I don't, what, blah, blah, blah. Like, I didn't want to do that. Like, I think some channels at least do, that don't comment on it, that just continue to make their daily videos without even mentioning it, especially some daily vloggers that are, they're just too afraid to be opinionated because they're too afraid people will unsubscribe because of it. So they're afraid to talk about it. And I think that's ridiculous. I think everyone should share their views on the things that they want to share their views on. But I also feel like if you just don't want to talk about it, if you just, you're sick of it and you don't give a shit, you shouldn't feel forced to comment on it, obviously. You shouldn't feel forced to care, you know. I think you should be kind of forced to care if you're a U.S. citizen, because it is your country that's in jeopardy. I'm just saying. But no, but I truly mean that. But also, the reason why I made this was also because I saw all of these really just angry tweets from people who I used to have respect for. I used to have, you know, a huge amount of respect for the people that you see the tweets from here. And they're great content creators and they're great people. And they do great work, and they seem like really nice people. But then, once the election comes up, they turn, you know, evil pretty much. You know what I mean? They turn vicious, and leave all their morals behind, and leave etiquette behind to just ridicule Donald Trump. I think it's disgusting. Anyway, so we move on to my CinemaSins parody, which, you know, to be honest with you, the last two videos that I've uploaded on my second channel, no, my main channel, sorry, before the best of video, so the last two videos of 2016, are videos that, it's the two videos, I'm sorry, I'm fucking up, it's the two videos that I'm, like, the most proud of in a long time. Like, I am so freaking proud of both this video and the top trending parody one. And I've actually began to love making videos where I don't necessarily include myself, where it's still my idea and my script and my voice and whatnot, but you just see something else on the screen. It's, you know, I've done it with the CinemaSins parody that you see here. I've done it with top trending parody. I've done it with the Eminem podcast episode 9. Like, I think I've just slowly began to realize that maybe I don't need to include myself in all my videos. I don't know. But let me know, obviously, should I make more content like this where you see something else on the screen except me? You know what I mean? You don't just see me on the screen, you know, because sometimes that can be good too. And you know, I love watching content from CinemaSins and from Top Trending, and I love that they don't do it. I think it would ruin their content a lot. And make them one of the other billions of list-based YouTubers if they were to to put themselves in the videos. That would just make them like Matthew Santoro. And I'm really glad they don't do that, Tom Trending. I'm really glad that they do have another style of doing it, where they actually put a ton of effort into it, finding all the stockpile footage and everything. But I don't know, man. Also because the video... I'm getting ahead of myself, but the video we're going to see after this one, the last video, you know, the Top Trending parody, that video took... I mean, I'm so proud of it, but it took such a long time to create. Like, because I just got so sick of it so fast editing it because of all the stock footage that had to be imported, because I felt like I was compensating for not having any visual footage. And it took me literal months to get it done, you know. Not because that's what it takes, but because I just got so sick of it so fucking fast. But the CinemaSins parodies, and I say that in plural because I've made two, like you can see that I'm talking about here. Those are actually really fun for me to create and also edit, and I'd actually love to do more. The thing is, I would probably do tons more, just because I think it's... You know, and actually create my own, maybe, film, making fun of film series. But the problem is, it's so copywritten. All the great content is copywritten. And I'm just not at a place on YouTube, subscriber-wise and viewer-wise, that I can get people to care if they copyright my shit. If, you know, my channel is taken down, you know. So, I don't think that I'm willing to risk it. I don't know, man. But I'm battling with that because I love to do that. I love to make videos critiquing real shit films because it's honestly really fun, and I'm a big film fan, you know. So I love to do more like this. But that's also why I chose this particular movie to do it with, because I thought these people are not going to copyright claim this, and YouTube's system is definitely not going to recognize this. So I should have a better chance at getting this to stay up, because I did make the Shallow Hal version, and that just got, you know, copyrighted, you know, and blocked worldwide instantly. Like, the minute that I uploaded it, it just became blocked worldwide. And, well, I think it was up for maybe a few minutes, I don't know. But it got copyrighted so fucking fast, obviously because of, you know, Fox. But, so that's why I chose this video. I watch I Hit Everything a lot, and his series, Search for the Worst, is amazing, by the way. But he did an episode about this movie, and I just thought it was too funny. And then I thought, you know, if I'm going to make that CinemaSins parody, I should do it of this one. But to be honest, this CinemaSins parody is mostly made to bring attention to the first CinemaSins parody that I made, because I used such a long time on the Shallow Hal video, and I wanted people to know. I didn't just want to randomly upload it to Facebook where no one is going to watch it. I wanted to say, okay, I want to integrate it on my main channel, but I don't just want to make a video saying, hey guys, please go to my Facebook and check out my CinemaSins parody. Like, I didn't want to do that because nobody's going to watch that. Nobody gives a fuck. So I was like, okay, I'm going to make another CinemaSins parody, but include it in the right way, like make it part of the video, and also place it in the middle of the video, so that when you're watching this, you'll see it, and you know, you'll be aware of the fact that I have actually made another one that you could go watch, you know what I mean? So I think it's just a really great way for me to get people to listen, because if I had put it in the beginning, people would just click off and not watch the rest of it, of this amazing video. And if I would have put it at the end, people would just once again click off because they're like, the video's done, you know. So I don't know, I think I came up with a good solution. This film, this shit film, uses sex appeal a lot, which sometimes it's a good thing for this movie, if you know, with their beautiful models. But there was that enormously fat woman and also this very muscular woman that you just saw, and those two women are not attractive. I'm sorry, that's just my personal opinion though, but they're not attractive. Like, that's not sex appeal, bro. That's just disgusting, you know what I mean? But anyway, this film is a fucking joke. Like, it's insane, and the fact that they used $300,000 on this fucking shit fest of a film, it's just insane to me. It's just insane, you know, and it gives me fucking nightmares. You know what I mean? But yeah, so all in all, it was just really funny to make this video that you're watching. It's just, and the sexual innuendos. It had so many of them. That's why I say this movie's a fucking joke. How am I going to take something serious that has that many sexual innuendos? Anyway, so now we get to my last video on the compilation list, which is the top trending parody. Now, I've already sort of explained a lot about this, because it was going off topic once again. But this is a video that I've actually wanted to make for a long time, because I watched a documentary about Kids Who Kill, and it was mostly about British children that had killed, you know, and the case with John Venables and the other dude, I can't remember his name, I'm sorry, but that case with those two boys that kidnapped this two-year-old, that is in that documentary that I saw, but I did some research and found other child killers that I haven't seen any videos or documentaries about, or, you know, listing them. So I was like, I'm gonna do this. That's a great topic. But the thing is, I wanted to make a top trending parody, but I, you know, every time I got an idea, I looked, I researched it. You know, I put it, I Googled it, you know, I YouTubed it. If you can say that. I just invented another word. I YouTubed it and saw that they had made just one just like it, with almost every idea that I got. But for this one, they have made their own version of, like, child killers, but or children who kill or whatever, but not with these particular children. So, you know, and just like whenever I do a parody, I try to make it my own. I'm not just the person that will do the Bart Baker version and just make fun of the people that's made it. I want to take the whole point in it for me is taking their concept and adding my own touch to it, kind of like you would do if you would cover a song. So that's how I view it when I make parodies. Most of the time, it's not about making fun of the creator. It's about tributing them. It's about honoring, for example, in this case, the massive amount of work that goes into the top trending videos. And now that I've made my own, I truly know how much work actually goes into the top trending videos. And I have no idea how the fuck they do it. Like, I have no idea. Like, how big is their team? And how how committed are these people? Because it's insane. The amount of work that goes into just one video, and they upload, like, several of them a week. Like, that's insane. Kudos to top trending. Like, you would never be able to do that if you were just one content creator. You know what I mean? This is actually a mistake, what you're watching right now. I probably shouldn't say that, but it is. There was supposed to be text, his quote, but I don't know what happened when I exported it, but it wasn't in the video, the text, and I uploaded it without realizing this, that it wasn't in it, so I was like, it's too late, but whatever, who cares, right? But yeah, you know, I'm sorry, I'm just listening to it. It's, the thing that I'm a huge fan of the Chop Trending videos are the videos that are spooky like this. So I wanted to make a real spooky video, you know, and I've gotten feedback, from people in my life that I've showed this video to, that have said, oh, you really get that feeling of being scared and, like, being, that it's real spooky. And obviously that was the entire point, you know? So I'm really glad but comment below, did it give you that feeling when watching it? Did it sort of, make you chill or whatever? Did it give you goosebumps? Let me know. Because that is the point. Robert Thompson and John Venables, right? I used so long time on this particular shot because it's obviously, I think you can still see it a lot, but, you know, it's obviously, it's a stock video or whatever, and I didn't want to buy it because I had to give, like, $80 for that one little clip, and I was like, I'm not doing that, are you fucking kidding me? So I try to edit my way out of it. But anyway, So that is the actual CCTV. Now, I actually originally thought there was going to be like actual footage of them walking away with this guy, but it's apparently just made up of pictures of it. But that's the only instance where I could actually take footage related to the case and show it, because with everything else in this, it's made up of videos and stock footage that is, I guess, unrelated, but not in the sense that it does relate to the topic, but just it's not directly the people that I talk about that are in whatever. Anyway, so we've actually made it to the end of the big compilation video, the best of Michael Nowak 2016 in full length with commentary. I hope you enjoyed this. My voice is gone. Thank you so much for listening. If you did, consider this a podcast with just me. Be sure to go check out the original video. Like, I don't know why you haven't, but just, you probably have. But go check it out nonetheless. There'll be a link in the description and on the screen. And I just want to say thank you for such an amazing 2016. I look forward to making so many more amazing videos in 2017. And I'm really excited for the future. So I just want to say thank you so much. And I'll see you next time. Love you. Bye.